So by now we start to have a good grip of the fundamental functions. We have seen last time how to compute their derivative, to interpret what it means. We even went to the higher order derivative. We could look at the concavity and the convexity, so the curvature of the graph of these functions. So we really start to have a good grip, but again, of the fundamental functions. And these functions are the polynomials. We've seen the square roots. We've seen the exponentials. We've seen the trigonometric functions. Well, only fundamental curves or functions. Now it is time to enlarge our set of functions, and to do that we are going to use these fundamental functions that we know. They would be the foundations to build other functions, and to do that we are going to consider two techniques or two tricks to build a function h out of two known or fundamental functions f and g. The notation that we will use for that is this circle, so that's a properly typeset way to represent that. I like to call it the fog formula when I want the student to remember the very important expressions that we are going to derive for these things. But let's first describe what it is, this process of composing function. This is notation for function composition. So the principle is quite simple. We've got a function f that has its domain A, and it brings us into another set, the codomain B. And then you've got the function g. So g here, I don't want to take the set c, because c like this is a set of complex numbers that might be a bit specific. So let's jump over to the next letter, which is d. And this is bringing us not in e or a new set. It brings us to the set a. Why? Because the function h is defined as follow. For any x that is from the domain of d, so it starts from d, the function h, which is, I remind you, h of x is defined as f g, that's a function of x. The definition, so now I can put the three signs, is f of g of x. This is this composition of function. This is defined by the function f taking as its argument another function, right? So therefore, you see that it brings us in the codomain of f, therefore it brings us to b. Let us look at some examples. It's always the best way to understand these things. So if we take, for instance, the function f, which is, I don't know, the square function. Yeah? We'll take, of course, the basic or fundamental function that we have seen already. And let's take another one, which would be the 4g, the sine function. Okay. So we see that f g, this function h, it is defined in such a way that it does f. That's the definition, f of j of x. So that's a f, let's go slowly, j of x is the sine of x, and f is taking the square by definition, so this is the square of x, which we write like this. We put the square directly on the sign. Another notation, which is equally acceptable, is this one. But it's slightly less elegant, it requires more parentheses, and it hides the fact that the square of applies to the function itself, to the sine, rather than to sine of x, which in principle is the number, yeah? It's the value of the sine evaluated at x. And precisely, we need the parentheses when we write sine of x square. We need the parentheses because otherwise what we get is the other function, which is the other one, j of x. This is, j is the sine, f is, so I can put the x here, f of x is the square, so that's like this. I can put the parentheses here, right? So if I write it like this, it might be a bit ambiguous. I believe that most people would understand that this is for this notation. Of course, I mean, it's easy to see that the square, so let's put parentheses where they will be useful, the sine of the square of x is different than the square of the sine. You can check it easily. If you are not convinced, let me plot for you here these two functions. So in principle, or in general, we have that this composition of function doesn't commute. Yeah, we cannot change the order. In some cases, it does commute. For instance, the function, if the function g is x the power function, xn, and I will call f another power function, then you can see that by the very nature of the symmetry and the commutation of the product itself, we've got g composited with f is equal to, so we start with f, that's xmn. On the other hand, we've got this opposite, which is n m, and both are equal because in both cases are equal to x m n, and because m n is equal to n m, we've got commutation of the product. Then in this particular case, we've got the commutativity of composition. In general, this is not the case, and of course it will turn out to be important for many applications. So now that we've got new functions like this, we can build a lot of functions. For instance, this function, exponential of x squared, that's an important function. If we have a minus here, we will see that we call that a Gaussian. It's a function which is bell-shaped like this, and it looks a bit like another composite function, by the way, which is missing the inverse and the and taking the square of this polynomial 1 plus x squared, which is the Lorentzian. So they are both bell-shaped, but they have very different properties, in particular statistical property, when we look at them in terms of distribution. But that's for later. So here we start to have an entire set of new functions. And when we have functions, we say what we want to do is to know about their derivative in particular. Yeah, that's what we did last lecture. We studied the derivative of the fundamental function. So now is the time to study the derivative of our composite function, which is what is the derivative of this composite function. So by definition, the derivative at evaluated at x will be, remember, there is a limit because we want to bring our secant in unison with the tangent. So we'll have to take the limit of the function at x plus epsilon, so this is the rate of change of the function, which is composite function, in the numerator, divided by the rate of change of the variable. Remember, I change the variable epsilon around x, that's epsilon. Now what happens to the composite function? It will change in a way that the ratio gives us the derivative. Okay, so how can we make progress there? We have to do some algebra, so we will make some rewriting. I'll always take the limit. I will not write the epsilon all the time. I will first expand what this is so that we can have a clear view of all this. And now we will reorganize and try to bring it in a form that we can work with it. So given that by definition of the composition of function, one function serves as the variable for the other, and the derivative is the ratio of the change of the function for the change of this variable. Well, it's interesting, maybe it will bring us somewhere, if we put in the denominator not the change of the ultimate variable when we go down the stairs of the composition, but the variable itself for f, which is this this thing, is g of x plus epsilon minus g of x. I will write it like this. So it starts to be what I want. You see that these two terms here, they cancel each other so that we still have the equal sign, provided that I don't forget anything. Okay, good. I mean, good. So far we did very little. For this, for us to be able to make a statement on the derivative of the composite of function, we will need to assume that both f and g are differentiable. Their derivative exist. So in particular, if the derivative exists for g, it means that by definition we've got this approximation, which becomes exact, it becomes an equal sign when epsilon goes to zero, when epsilon is an infinitesimal. So this is the derivative there. I will work with this one by taking the f of this, and f I also assume this is differentiable. If f is differentiable, it means that I've got expanding my function f around this point, which is g of x, and I'm making a step, a deviation of my variable by this amount, which is very small because this is finite and epsilon is infinitesimal. So the product of something finite multiplied by an infinitesimal is infinitesimal. So that gives me epsilon g prime of x times the derivative evaluated at g of x, at the point where we are looking again. Very good. So I substitute this there. Remember, we are looking at this thing. Therefore, that gives us the limit of this term will cancel with this one. We are left with epsilon g prime x f prime g of x, divided by g of x plus epsilon minus g of x, and I need not forget this term. If I copy it, I will save myself the embarrassment of not copying it correctly, we could cancel this epsilon there. But rather than canceling this epsilon, what I will do is that I will bring this one here in the denominator. Jumping a lot. Why am I doing this? So you see, as I did, I multiply by 1 over epsilon this both terms. So it cancels in the numerator and it appears there in the denominator. Okay, why this looks a good thing to do? Because you see that these two quantities, actually they cancel right away. I'm making it more complicated than I should. So I can cancel this epsilon. I don't have to do that. Let's undo if we can. Let's see if I can go. Okay, so we cancel them here, and then this cancels directly. I was about to take some limits, but we find that we've got the good result. It's actually more straightforward than I remembered. We've got the good result, which is that this is f prime g x times g prime. So return in terms of the composition of function, this is like this. So this is the formula that we write. If we start with the fog, we've got that the derivative of the composite function is the derivative of the first function composited with the other one multiplied, so that's the product there, by g prime. That's a very important function that tells you how to take derivative of composite functions. Now that I look at this proof, it's so straightforward that I wonder if it's completely correct or accurate. So let's revise it if you want together. We started with this definition of the composite function, right? So that's fine here. Then we said that g is differentiable, so I can write it in this form. I'm going a bit fast there because I remove all the arguments of the limit. So I assume this is exact because of the infinitesimal. I do the same with f. I mean, I don't see any particular problem. And I know that this result is correct because it is so important that I know it by heart. And so should you from now know it by heart. But before you learn it, let's make sure that we practice it. We understand what it means. So we've looked at this function, for instance. So let's look at this Gaussian again. Yeah, we'll take the derivative of the Gaussian. So to describe this function h of x, I will say that h of x is the result of f, which is the exponential, and g, which is the square, or the minus square. Doesn't matter where I put it. Okay, you agree with me that h as a result is f g of x. So let's differentiate. H is f prime composited with g multiplied by g prime. So we compute f prime is still the exponential, and g prime is very easy, the derivative of a polynomial is minus 2x, x to the power of 2 minus 1. Therefore, if we substitute, this is the exponential composited with this thing multiplied by g prime. So I can put it in front because it's better to have the polynomial before the exponential. That's the derivative of minus x squared. Okay. If you want, let's do the Lorentzian as well. Like this, we are complete. So here we are compositing for f. We could say that we are taking the inverse. And for g, we are having 1 plus x squared. So this is f prime, the inverse, the derivative of the inverse, I know you know it by heart now, is minus the inverse of the square. So I will have to square here g. G is 1 plus x squared, so we square it from the derivative, multiply by this, which is 2x. Right, constant gets 0, and we got again the derivative of the square of the monomial. So this is therefore minus 2x, 1 plus x squared to the power of 2. Okay. When we've got things like this, we could use it to look functions that I believe so far were out of reach. The tangents, for instance, I told you the geometric definition of the tangent was the following. That's this quantity. So we have to look when we make a delta theta, what happens with the ratio this divided by this delta theta, which will be this distance. So we will have to make again some maybe trigonometry. So I'm not too sure how straightforward it is in this way, the geometrical one, but certainly it's not as straightforward as to remember that by Euler relation the tangent of x or theta is the product of the sine, use x over the cosine. And if we apply this composition of function, the derivative of the of this, so here we could have the inverse with the inverse cos with the sine, it will be straightforward. So actually, let me tell you that as well as composition, this is useful, this thing, to know the general derivative, the rules of derivation, not for function of x, but for function themselves. Like for instance, if we've got the product, we've got that this is this one. And this was left as a problem from your last lecture for you to work out by applying the definition of the derivative, right? Work it out now or have a look at the solution of the problem. So let's have a look in the tutorial if you want. The point is that these kind of things we need to know. Yeah, if alpha is a constant, this is alpha f prime. The sum is the derivative of the sum is the sum of the derivative, so on and so forth. And then when it comes to things like this, so like f square, so by applying f square, you see that this is f prime, f plus f f prime. So this is 2f f prime, right? In more general, we've got this thing, n f prime f n minus 1. So if we got the particular case n equal 2, you see that it recovers this. And this looks like a generalization of extension, or the case that you know for the variable n, which is that the derivative of the monomial n is nx n minus 1. So let's demonstrate this one. Here we will take f as itself, and we will take g as the function that takes the nth power, as the power function. Yeah? Therefore, we've got g f, this is, so let's not forget gof, but we need to know it in any order, even if it would be u and v over name for the function. So it's g prime composited with f times f prime. G prime is n, the function, so x that takes composite with f, so that makes f n minus 1, okay? That's what we've got inside the parentheses, multiplied by f prime. So hopefully, if I didn't make a mistake, that's the same result as here. So that's the formula for n. So like this, we have other things like f over g or the inverse of f. Let's start with the inverse of f. You can prove now that this is minus f prime over f squared. So fg, the derivative of fg, is f prime g minus fg prime divided by g squared. And lots of things like this. So let's look at the square root of f. That's f prime over 2 square root of f. So on and so forth. Actually, the same as it works for the variable x, we can find this derivative here by using this formula, this one or this one, for the case n equal 1 half. Remember that square root is the power 1 half. So that works in this case. So I put you here for your convenience, again, the list of important general formulas or expression that concerns derivative of functions, of which the particular case of function of single variable, there are particular cases by definition, that's what they are. You need to know both. So let's come back to our tangent. If we apply this this formula that we just looked at here, for the tangent, we will find the derivative of the tangent of x. That's the derivative of sine over cos. That's the derivative of the sine, which is the cos, multiplied by the denominator, which is the cos, so that's cos squared, minus sine. Now, the derivative of the cos is the minus sine, so that makes plus sine squared, divided by the square of the denominator, that's cos squared. Cos squared plus sine squared by Pythagoras is equal to 1. So that's the derivative of the tangent. This is the inverse square. X. Okay, so that's an important result. Okay, let's leave it at that for the composition of function. That's already an important technique. That's a big part of our trick to make new functions out of old one, out of familiar one or fundamental one. Now let's look at something related that also involves the principle of composition, but with the particular result that this time it will be commutative, and on top of that he will evaluate to this particular functions which we call so one or the identity, there are various names for it. The identity, we've seen it already, the function that for any variable returns itself, right? So for the function of x, this is the diagonal, the identity. Okay, so if f is as a function g that satisfies this, then we say that g is the inverse of f, and we write it like this. Here we must be careful that this notation of the inverse is not to mean 1 over f. It's really confusing, but there is really a convention because two different, the same notation is used for two different conventions. One is the real inverse of the function, the other is the inverse in the sense of composition. It's the function that undoes, is the function that undoes what another function is doing. Let's look at particular case of inverse function. So for instance, the square function. Familiar easy function, yeah? Square. What is the inverse of the square? It's a function that if we apply to the square, it gives us the variable itself. It's what I need to do to the square so that it gives me x. What is this function? This is clearly the square root. So we'll draw it actually. And here we have to make a first observation that the square root is the inverse of the square. A function, by our definition, if you go back to our lecture on the function, it has to be single valued, which means that for any x I give it, it will return one value. So I cannot do this again. Yeah, I told you last time already, and it's something that becomes especially salient when we deal with complex number, but I told you that minus square root of x is a good square root for x, because if I take the square of this, the minus cancels, becomes 1, and then we got x. So in principle, it could be this, the inverse function. So we decide to take only the upper part. So the domain of the square root is not r, it's r plus. Otherwise, you have to go to a complex number. There is a nice geometrical thing about the inverse function that I can show you on a piece of paper. So I will write it there. I will put my function x again. That's the square. I'll show you here. I'm doing it again on this piece of paper. Right? Now, how to look the inverse, how to find the inverse there, is the function for which this is now the axis, this is the function, and this one is the variable. So I have to look at it in this way. I use this this piece of paper and this thick pen in the hope that you see the transparency. Yeah? So that's y now, and that's the value of the axis. You see, I swapped the paper and I turn it upside down. I hope you can see, you can recognize the square root there. Let's do the same with, I've got now a different color, but I'm not sure this one is working so well. Let's do the same with another function, like the sine function. I will do the sine. Okay, so that's my sine in red. I'm showing you the sine, you recognize the sine. It's linear around, so 0 at 0, of course. It behaves like a line, then here we've got pi over 2, sorry, 90 degrees, we didn't introduce the radian yet. This is 190 degrees, and we've got here this projection of the circle. So now, let's look at this trick at turning the functions. We need to look at it in this way. Okay, so for you, that becomes now the variable, and that becomes the function itself. So now we've got this problem, you see, if we look at if it's transparent enough, I'm not sure it is, so I will copy it again. I'm just, because I've got better eyesight than the camera, probably not, but I've just copied it, what I see. Yeah? So if you don't trust me, do it at home, it's a very easy experiment. This is the function that I copied, you see? See it clearly, right? I will put as well the axis. That the axis, they seem to show a bit better. Okay, you see the function. And you see the inverse function. Function, inverse function. So here you got the problem of double valuedness. You see that for this value of our variable, we've got this value of the function here, and this value of the function. So we have to cut. So what we will take is this. I will do it again. So I remove the part, this part we don't consider. So here you got the inverse of the sine function. This function is an important one. We call it the arcsine function. I will draw it again there. That's the arcsine function. Let's look together, if you want, at the values that it takes. It's defined between minus 1 and 1. That's the domain of the arcsine function, because the sine, remember, is the projection on the trigonometric circle whose radius is 1 by definition, so it can only be between minus 1 and 1. So here it doesn't take any value. And then what are the extremum value there? Well, this is the value at which the sine becomes 1. This is 90 degrees. So we would like to put 90 degrees. So now I will have to put the radian notation. So we see that 90 degrees corresponds to pi divided by 2. And this is the opposite, minus pi divided by 2. So 314 divided by 2. That's the way the function works. You see that it's very interesting. The arcsine, like the sine, is also a line at the origin, around zero, which comes from the fact, which follows straightforwardly from the fact that the inverse of the identity is the identity itself. So, but since we are speaking about curvatures, we see that here there's something interesting that happens with the curvature. The derivative actually becomes infinite. We didn't see so far any function that was taking an infinite derivative, exactly infinite. So this is the case there. Well, let's compute the derivative of this arcsine function. So that's what we are going to do now, to compute the derivative of the arcsine. Do you know what it is by any chance? Have you, maybe when you were learning the list of derivative of functions, memorize the derivative of the arcsine? If you didn't, you will have to now. Well, at least you will know where it comes from, and you will see a very beautiful result. It's kind of unexpected, because when we look at the derivative of trigonometric functions, we are imagining that it will give us over trigonometric functions. But we will see this is not the case. So to do that, before we apply it to the particular case of the arcsine function or over functions, we need to know what is the derivative of the inverse function. So remember the inverse function. We define it like this. Is a function, where is it? Is the function g that, here it is. I can copy that. It would have been simpler to actually write it again. Okay. Okay. So we've got a function, I will write it like this. Y, which is a function of x, we define the inverse function g. I will not write g, I will call it h. H is a function of y, such that h of f of x is equal to x, or equivalently f of h of y is equal to y. So we are going to look at the derivative of h by using the FOG formula, the derivative of composite function. Why? Because y is this, put it there, so y is f of x, so what we get there, as you recognize, is h f of x. Okay, so that's the derivative of the composite function. So we said derivative of the composite function is h prime f times f prime, and now let's look. H prime of f, h prime of f of x, because f takes its value as x, this is closing this parenthesis, time f prime of x. So f of x, we said that f of x is y, and f prime of x, I can put here, for x I can put h of y. Okay, and by definition h of f of x is equal to the identity, because h of f is the identity by definition of h being the inverse of f. Therefore, here this is the derivative of x. Yeah, this is the derivative of the identity, which is 1. Derivative of x is 1. So this is equal to 1. And that brings us to the results. We've got h prime of y is the inverse, so this time the real inverse, taking 1 divided by this thing, is f h. And we can get rid of the variable y because it works for all of them. So let's put this in a box. The derivative of h prime, we can write it either like this, or I will put it in a different color here to keep the variable because it's not needed. That's the formula that we can use. The derivative of the inverse function is 1 divided by, so real inverse. The derivative of the direct function, the one of which we are taking the inverse, composited with the inverse itself. Let's apply it to the sine. So to apply it to the sine, the arc sine. Yeah, we've got the function y equal sine of x. We've got as a result x is the arc sine of y. We said that this is f of x, this one is h of y. We want the derivative of the arc sine, which is the derivative of h. This is 1 over the derivative of the sine here, f prime. The derivative of the sine is the cosine, composited with h. H is the arc sine, so it's the cosine of the arc sine of y. So it's 1 divided by the cosine of the arc sine. So it's almost the good answer, but I told you that we would find a nice result which is not in terms of trigonometric function, and yet it's full of ugly trigonometric function of course of arc sine. Remember, the arc sine is the inverse of the sine, so sine of arc sine is the identity. Here we are mixing the cos and the arc sine. But whenever we've got a cos and we want to trade it into a sine, it's easy, we use Pythagoras, cos squared plus sine squared equal 1, because here we can say this is the square root of the cos squared. The cos square is 1 minus the sine square, so we've got 1 minus the sine square, so it's the sine of the arc sine of y squared, because the sine square, it means that the square is on the sine. So we've got the sine of the arc sine is y, that gives us 1 divided by square root of 1 minus y squared. So that's the result. The derivative of the arc sine, surprisingly, of y, doesn't involve any trigonometric function. It involves an inverse and a square root and square. So it's not particularly pretty. And you can see indeed when y is equal to plus or minus 1, this becomes infinite, which is the observation we made there. Goes to infinite. It's a very beautiful result. I let you as well, or we'll see that when we look at the next lecture, where this time we look at Taylor expansion, that indeed around zero this is linear. Okay, so we look at the arc sine. We will conclude this by looking at the exponential. But before the exponential, I believe I forgot to tell you about the inverse of one important family of functions that we postponed already. We said that when you are looking at function, we introduce this this power function, very important function, of course, yeah? Xp or xn, where n is an integer. Okay, and we said that we will not look at the power of the rational integers or the rational things. Yeah? We say we leave it for later. So why? Because we can take this again. Okay, actually we did it for the square root already. So this is the square. Yeah, let's look at the square. We said the inverse is the square root. So if we look at the cube. So the cube, I will use the same graph but a different color. Remember, the cube is smaller below 1, it's above below 1. Now I cannot do it with the tablet, which you see on the screen, but if I put it on the computer, it looks like that. Yeah, that's the real tablet now that you see there. But I cannot do this trick easily on the piece of paper. So you'll have to trust me or do it at home, that it does something like this, where your intuition can tell you that it looks reasonable. So that's the cubic root. Okay, so we've got this very nice symmetry around the identity, which is here in green itself, its own inverse. Okay. So let me show you actually plotted here the nice result. Here you've got the power up to 5. So you see how they get cluttered together. But why it's nice? Because this problem of the inverse with this rational function, why is the good way to look at it? Because we've got this beautiful thing that the pif power, the pif root of x, we said by definition, we can write it like this. Okay, that's how we define the pith root of x. Okay, so taking the inverse of this, it means that we are taking in a different color the p there. That's taking the p there. But you see that because of the algebra. And this is x commutes like this, of course. Yeah, I can put the parenthesis like this, because both are actually equal to x p1p or x 1pp, which is x. So that shows again that's the identity of x, that shows that the pith power is the inverse of the pith root. And it all comes from this algebra. So we are back to our very first lecture when we are looking at how we define these quantities. Okay, very nice. So that's for the inverse of the powers that I didn't want to forget because we had postponed them already and they are important, of course. So don't be scared about them. They are very simple functions. Let's conclude with the exponential because I told you the exponential might be actually the most important function for physics. So it's nice to conclude any lectures with the exponential. So the exponential, remember, is these functions. So the exponential, and we are going to speak about the natural exponential, which means that this is the power of this Euler number 271, etc., which is obtained as the infinite series of the inverse of the reciprocal of the factorial. But in red, the exponential function, it looks like this. Yeah. And we now that we know the derivative, we know that, for instance, that 0 is equal to 1, because exponential of 0, like the 0 of power of any number is always 1, and the derivative is equal to 1. There, because it's its own derivative. Yeah, that's how we've seen last time. So here it's like this. These things should be okay. Tangent. It's not exact because I'm not drawing really well. Yeah, but in principle, here it should be going like the diagonal. Okay. So, what is the inverse of this exponential? So, same business, we could return the thing and look at the function. So, in particular, because the exponential only takes positive values for the real variable, its inverse will have the domain which is r plus. It will not be defined for the negative values. But let's try to characterize this function. We'll give it a name, actually. So, the inverse of the function, we call it the logarithm. And if it's for the natural exponential, which means the power of e, we call it the natural logarithm, so ln, or Neperian logarithm. The n actually could be for Neperian. So that's log of x is equal to x of log is equal to the identity, yeah, equal to x. So let's apply this trick of before, like we did with the arcsine, to compute the derivative of the arcsine. We'll define the function x that or f, the function that to x give us the exponential of x, and the function h which to y give us the logarithm of y, such that h is the inverse of f. We've got h of f of x is equal to x, and we look at the derivative of h prime of y, and we say this is 1 over f prime h. Yeah, let me copy it there just to satisfy ourselves. Copy it from there. F prime of h of y. So I can put this so that I put the variable. So we compute. F prime is very easy. The exponential derivative is itself. So I've got the exponential. I composite it with the function itself, which is the logarithm. And here we've got this nice result that we are composing its function directly with its inverse. So when applied to the variable, which is the identity, we get rid of it. That gives us y. So we've got this very nice result that the logarithm of x. So we use now instead of y, I use x because we have this convention, the variable is x and y is the function. So I can make this change of variable so the result in the conventional form. The derivative of the logarithm is the inverse function. And this is really an important result, which is very nice because it starts to connect everything. Now we are connecting the exponential with the inverse, through, I mean, with the real inverse, the 1 divided by x, through its inverse in the sense of composition of functions. That's really kind of a surprising and very deep result if you think about it. So we'll conclude with that. I will let you think about it. Next lecture, we start over where we left it in terms of the Taylor expansions. We needed to stop there to look at two differential composite of functions, because when we do Taylor expansion, we'll be interested in looking at Taylor expansions of composite functions. So think about this.